I'm just a lawsuit. Yes, I'm only a lawsuit. And I need someone to resolve my dispute. So, how does a case get to the Supreme Court? Despite what you may hear on TV or in the movies, you can't just take it to the Supreme Court.
I'll appeal. I'll take it to the Supreme Court.
The Supreme Court will only hear a very small fraction of cases involving a very small fraction of disputes. The Supreme Court only hears three types of suits, and that is appeals from state courts where there's a constitutional question at stake, appeals from federal courts, or a third type of case, and that's cases where the Supreme Court has what's called original jurisdiction. So how does it all start? It starts as a dispute. That's what a lawsuit is after all. It's two people who cannot agree about something, so they need a neutral arbiter to figure it out. Let's say that you are a small business owner and you own a farm, and you have union organizers come onto your farm that's not open to the public, and they're claiming the right to organize. And you try to kick them off, but they say that they're entitled to be there under state law 3 hours a day, 120 days a year. And you think that's wrong. You say, hey, that is a violation of my rights. I'm entitled to just compensation under the 5th and 14th Amendments of the United States Constitution. So you go to federal court so that the court can resolve this dispute. You're gonna start at the court of first resort, that is the lowest court, and it's called the district court. And at this point, this is where the court's resolving all of the factual issues. And after it resolves those factual issues, it'll make a legal conclusion. You make your arguments and you either win or you lose. And in fact, we lost this case called Cedar Point. And so you have two options. You either give up, which is sad, or you can appeal. If you appeal, you go to one of 13 what's called circuit courts. Circuit courts are groups of appellate courts, and they arise in different parts of the country, and if your lower court is in that part of the country, you go to that circuit. Now, appellate argument is very different than the district court, where you're sort of just making your case, you know, in the sort of dramatic trial court scenes that you see in movies.
And the truth shall set you free!
In the appellate court, you're gonna be before three judges, and they're just hammering you with questions. They're interrupting each other, they're interrupting you, they are testing the limits of your legal assertions, they're throwing hypotheticals out at you. It is very intimidating.
Our slate this year, so he's not challenging that, am I correct?
No, Your Honor, because whoever ends up being nominated, it's shareholders who have the ultimate responsibility to
right.
either-
Right, I just wanna be clear.
So you wait for an opinion, and generally this is not a quick process. In fact, in the Cedar Point case, the case was filed in July of 2016. It was argued in November of 2017. And it was decided a year and a half later in May of 2019. So it can take a very long time to get a decision. And once again, you're either gonna win or you're gonna lose. If you've lost, once again, you can give up, you can petition to the Supreme Court, or you can petition for what's called rehearing en banc. And what that is you are asking a bigger panel of judges from that circuit to reconsider the question. You have to ask them based on the argument that there is a very important question at stake and or the panel's decision is creating a conflict within the circuit. In that case, it might be that the circuit wants to take a look at it again to make sure there's no conflict. So what's the upside of doing that? The upside is that you get a second bite at the apple and you have another opportunity to win. But even if you lose, you may elicit a vigorous dissent that will convince the Supreme Court that on petition to the Supreme Court, your case is worth taking. And in fact, that's exactly what happened with Cedar Point. We asked for a petition for a hearing en banc, and the court ultimately decided not to take up the question again, but Judge Ikuda wrote a dissenting opinion with seven other judges saying that they thought that that opinion was wrong, and it was very vigorous and persuasive, and it may have played a role in what happened next. At that point, you're going to ask the Supreme Court for what's called a petition for writ of certiorari. certiorari, petition for cert. You're going to ask for a petition for cert. And that is a Latin term that means to make clear. You're asking the highest court to make clear what the law really is. And so you're going to ask the court to grant the appeal. And once again, you can't just suggest that the opinion is wrong. The Supreme Court is not interested in resolving minor disputes where a lower court might have gotten things wrong. That might happen quite frequently. What you want to argue is that this is a question of national importance and a question where courts are split across the country such that individuals don't really know what the law is. It's unclear. They're living under different rules depending on what circuit they live in or different state. And you need the Supreme Court to resolve this issue. If there's no split, it's a little less likely that the court's gonna take it up. Usually the Supreme Court likes to let things percolate a little bit, see how it plays out in the courts, and then once other courts have had the benefit of working through it, then it will take up the case to resolve the question. So the Supreme Court makes decisions from the first Monday in October through July. If your petition is not before the court by July, you're gonna be put in what's called the long conference. That's the conference in the summer when the justices are on vacation, and they're going to resolve it when they come back in the long conference. Even if you're not in the long conference, it's really unlikely your case is going to be heard. The court gets 8,000 petitions per year, and it only grants 80. At that point, your opposing counsel may file an opposition. It doesn't have to. If it chooses to just ignore you, the court may then call for a response. Now, that's a pretty good thing if you get a call for a response. It highly increases the odds that your case is going to be taken. Instead of 1%, it's 5 to 7%. So, still pretty low. But even a call for response signals that there's some interest in the court. If your opposing counsel just chose to ignore you and to not write an opposition, it's pretty unlikely the court's gonna grant the case without calling for a response, because it wants to hear what the other side has to say and what the weaknesses are in your argument before it grants the case. So after that, you're gonna really struggle to get a reply in quickly, the optional reply before the court sits at conference. The court's gonna have a conference and decide whether to grant your case, and maybe you hit the jackpot. And that's exactly what happened in Cedar Point. Our case was granted. So if your case is granted, then you have to do it all over again on the merits. You submit a brief on the merits explaining why you're right. Opposing counsel will oppose, and then you will write a reply and you will go to argument. After argument, the court conferences and they decide how to vote. And after that, the case is decided. And after every conference, the justices shake hands. I think that's important. Important to note that collegiality is very important on the court. Justice Scalia said that when you're a judge, you have to be able to attack ideas and not people. And if you can't separate the two, then you shouldn't be a judge. And then you wait, and you wait, and you wait.
And you wait, and you wait.
Because there's no deadline for the Supreme Court. And eventually, they're gonna issue a decision. You might get a per curiam opinion, which means all of the justices write together in your favor. You might get a majority opinion with a concurrence or a dissent, but hopefully you win. That's how you get there. That's how you get to the Supreme Court. If you like this video and want to hear even more about the Supreme Court, check out my new podcast, Dis, from Pacific Legal Foundation.